This is Whitley Strieber, and this is Dreamland. You've reached the edge of the world.
Well, today we have a truly extraordinary guest, one of the great, certainly one of the most important people in the who is connected in any way with UFOs. Danny Sheehan has been a very busy man over the years, goodness knows. He started with the Christic Institute, who founded it, I think, in 1986. Is it, Danny? Yeah.
1980, actually.
1980. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And has such a history. The highlights in my life are, of course, the Karen Silkwood case, the Pentagon Papers, and what I would describe as a generalized attempt to save the world from itself. By forcing people to tell and look at the truth. He has repped Stephen Greer's Disclosure Project. He has he repped John Mack, who was a dear friend of mine, and I have always been felt a very special bond because of his tireless efforts on and effective efforts on John's behalf. And there's just so much to say about him. Welcome to Dreamland and to the Close Encounter Witness world, where few dare to tread. So,
thank you.
Your friend Lou Elizondo, who I know you have worked with and are working with, is afraid won't even come on this show. Chris Mellon, nor most of those people. Because they're afraid of being tarred by the experiencer brush. They want to be believed, or certainly not David Grush. They want to be believed. And if they get tangled up with us, they figure that's going to go by the boards very quickly. But let's get into this right away. The axis of Dreamland's involvement with the Close Encounter Witnesses issue has always been the witnesses, the Close Encounter Witnesses. And I'm wondering, I've heard stories that you may be planning to present or presenting experiencers to Senate and House committees. Is this the case?
Well, as you point out, Whitley, that the people inside government structures seem to have gotten a memo comparatively recently that there has been a decision made somewhere on high to begin to disclose more information about the UFO or UAP issue. But they've not yet really gotten into acknowledging that there's ever been any kind of direct encounter with the occupants of the phenomenon. That they've kind of rigidly bifurcated this the reality into saying, well, there seem to be some sort of vehicles or craft or phenomena that are displaying inordinate capacities at speed and maneuverability, etc. But they still maintain that they have no idea what they are. They haven't even fully acknowledged that their craft or vehicles. Now, David Grush has come the closest to it. He has actually acknowledged that there is UFO crash retrieval program that has been underway for some time in the United States government, and that they've recovered bodies of occupants of the vehicles, which they've determined are not human. Now, that's a bridge that most of the people involved inside the government structures with the UFO phenomenon have refused to cross. They just keep talking about the vehicles. So that as of right now, the people who have the majority of the people who have come forward to the Senate Intelligence Committee and have provided information to the Senate Intelligence Committee have been focusing on the crash retrieval program, to try to get across the line to the people in the Senate, in the House, their elected members, that yes, there has been and is now going on a major active crash retrieval program of recovering craft and attempting to back engineer them. So that they've, the two issues they're dealing with is the crash retrieval and the back engineering program. They seem to have kind of focused upon that issue to be soliciting whistleblowers on that issue. Now, the additional issue of the recovery of the bodies of any of the occupants is the next bridge that they've got to deal with. And at least Grush has acknowledged that they've recovered bodies that they've been able to do biological tests on to find out that they're non-human. They have not yet crossed the Rubicon on the issue of live occupants or any kind of direct face-to-face encounters with the occupants. So therefore, you don't get them acknowledging the Holloman Air Base, Air Force Base landing. You don't get them acknowledging the Edwards Air Force Base landing of any UFOs. And you certainly don't get them acknowledging the bona fides of any of the citizen direct encounters, the many thousands of encounters of which we have a kind of graphic detail in very specific information from people, very many of whom are extraordinarily credible. And a number of them, you know, officials in government, law enforcement officials, people in political office have encountered the beings, et cetera. But the present disclosure process that is underway in Washington, D.C., to date, seems to be confined specifically to the crash retrieval program and the back engineering of the technology. They want to stay fixed on the technology aspects of this thing, and they haven't interviewed, you know, that in talking, what talking I've done to any of the people that are involved in the program, nobody in Congress has been asking them about the direct face-to-face encounters, and they don't seem to be ready yet to come to grips with that. And I know that the Aero Office is not. The Aero Office is, has said that they're open to any communication to them about the non-human intelligence, but they profess at the present time, as you know, to have been provided no information whatsoever that has given light on any of the questions about there being an actual organic biological intelligence behind the piloting of the UFOs. And so I've of course in representing Dr. John Mack and having been legal counsel for the Project on Extraordinary Experience Research for a while, I've had a number of interviews with people who've professed to have these direct live encounters with the beings. And I just spoke yesterday afternoon again with Barbara Lamb, again, for example, a very widely respected person who has had direct encounters, face-to-face encounters.
Yeah, with I know live. Barbara. She's been interviewed on the show. So yes. Yeah, go
ahead. But the Congress is not yet open to taking testimony on that whole category of encounters yet. But we're poised to be able to present that information to them. But we're trying to get first through to the crash retrieval and the back engineering issue right now in front of Congress.
Visit Danny Sheehan at newparadigminstitute.org. New Paradigm Institute is a 501c3 open for donations. You can also engage with your elected representatives there very easily. New Paradigm Institute, don't miss it. Danny and I will both be at Contact in the Desert this summer. You can find out more at contactinthedesert.com, May the 29th to June the 3rd in Indian Wells, California. It's going to be an extraordinary conference. Don't miss either of us, and don't miss this conference. These things are getting more important every day.
unknowncountry.com. It's huge. It's much more than just a Whitley Strieber book site. It contains thousands of hours of interviews, meditations, podcasts of all kinds. My original hypnosis tapes are there. You can actually hear the moment that I discovered that I, at least, was not alone in this universe in the office of Dr. Donald Klein so many years ago. Whitley Strieber audiobooks, Communion, Transformation, The Secret School, Breakthrough, Majestic, and so much more, powerful meditations, but more even than all that, it is a community of people who are either looking to gain contact or actually in contact now. There is no community like it in the world. It is absolutely unique. Contact really is happening here. That's what these shows are all about. That's what my life and this website are about. It's real, and it can be of enormous benefit to us individually and to mankind as long as we take our part and do it our way. This is what being a member of Unknown Country is about. So go to unknowncountry.com and subscribe today. Join us and join, very frankly, the future. Who are they? Why are they here? What do they want with us? Why is it all so secret? All of these questions are explored in my new book, Them, in an entirely new way. What do Close Encounter reports tell us about what the visitors want with us? What is the military's experience? And can our memories be trusted? Can anything be trusted? Them answers all of these questions in a totally new way. It's available in hardcover, softcover, as a Kindle, and as an audiobook, read by me. Get Them today, and you can get it from the unknowncountry.com store, signed by me.
Robert Bigelow ended up, after going to the Skinwalker Ranch, having a close encounter experience with his wife that he described on 60 Minutes. And there are a number of military and CIA officers I know who have had similar encounters. And it seems to me that to some extent, whatever this presence is capable of selecting people that it particularly wants. And I've wondered whether or not, and I've had certain indications that can't go into because they're too vague, that people in Congress might have had experiences in the past year or so. I wondered if any of those rumors have reached your ears, and if so, no. If they have any credit. None.
No, okay. I don't know. I don't know of any one particular. I know in a conversation I've had with military personnel, they've indicated that they were communicating with one or more members of Congress, and one of them indicated that one of the congressmen indicated that they'd had a personal experience, but so
it's the same congressman. I suspect that I'm not going to go down that path, but right. Suffice to say that that could continue. I would guess, and my guess, it might expand as well. And I know it's already very much that many people in the DOD have been involved, and in the military in particular.
Yes.
Because if you go into their bailiwick, they tend to come into yours. You do a combat air patrol that involves making aggressive maneuvers toward one of these objects. And the next thing you knew, your kids are saying there's weird creatures in my bedroom. So that has happened. Now let's go back here. We are in a situation where right now it seems to me that the Schumer Amendment has recently been just gutted.
Well, they use that term, Billy, as you know, there was a 64-page bill that was drafted by the Senate Intelligence Committee, and that it passed the Senate Intelligence Committee 17-0. All eight of the Republican senators and all nine of the Democratic senators approved that. It was approved overwhelmingly by the Senate. It went over to the House side, and the vast majority of members of the House supported the 64-page bill. But the Republican chairman of the Senate Intelligence Committee, the House Intelligence Committee, Michael Turner, he got the agreement of Michael Johnson, who's the acting Speaker of the House right now, to refuse to put the 64-page bill on the floor. And there were very specific things that were causing him to refuse to put that 64-page bill onto the floor of the House for a vote. And what he agreed to do, however, which is very important, is he agreed to put onto the floor 24 pages of the bill. And it was the same bill that came out of the 64-page bill. And there were some major differences, but what the 24-page bill did is it issued a direct command by the United States Congress, which was signed by the president, ordering all six of the United States military services, all 18 of the United States intelligence agencies, all 32, I think it is, agencies of the United States Defense Department, and all of the private aerospace industry corporations that had any information about the UFO phenomenon or the non-human intelligence that is associated with the UFO phenomenon, to turn over all of the information that they have on this to the National Archives. Now, that part of the bill survived, and so that order has been given now, and the Library of Congress has set up a special section of the National Archives to receive that information, and all of those agencies are under a direct command from Congress, signed by the president now, to turn over this information to the archives. And now they've been ordered. They haven't put a date on the date of the turnover, but they have put a date on, in effect, the date by which they have to have it all compiled. So they have 300 days from December 22nd of 2023, which I've computed out to be around October 18th of this year, which is, interestingly enough, like some 2 weeks or 3 weeks before the national election. They have to have compiled all of the information that they have, each of those different agencies, and they have to put it into a digital format, and they need to have an index, which is searchable, computer searchable, to recover the information. And they have to designate what of that information they're willing themselves, each of the agencies are themselves willing to allow to be made public. And with regard to any of the provision, any particular piece of information that they believe ought to be withheld and not made available to the public, they have to give a specific reason for it. And they've been given certain limitations on what criteria they can use for that. Now, all of that has been passed into law, and that is operational right now. Those of us who had been hoping that the 64-page bill would pass the House as it had the Senate, you know, were disappointed by the reduction of the 64-page bill down to 24 pages. And there were certain very key elements of the 64-page bill that were removed For example, very importantly, the 64-page bill provided for the president to appoint a 9-person board that would actually review all of this information when it was handed in. And that board would make the decision as to what information was going to be made available to the public. And that board, if it was going to be advising the retention of any of the information to be kept secret, they would have to be able to justify it according to a certain set of specific criteria. Now, the change that has been made is that, and very disappointingly, the agency that is now able to decide what portion of the information, if any, will be made public, still resides in the hands of the 6 military services and the 18 intelligence agencies and the 32 Defense Department agencies and the aerospace corporations. These are the very parties that have been keeping it secret. These are the very parties that have been lying about its mere existence up to this point. So that is extremely disappointing. But the command has still been given that they need to compile the information and turn it over to the National Archives. And the National Archives has not been authorized to make any decision about what shall be revealed. So that what we're dealing with right now is, in a certain sense, if you consider the 64-page bill the 100% bill right now, in the 24-page bill to be, you know, I don't know, approximately a third of that, I would say that we've accomplished a little less than a third of what the objectives were for the first bill. So 2/3 of the bill having been removed effectively, you could argue is gutting it. I mean, and that's been used, and other people have referred to it by even more pejorative terms. Of what's happened to the bill.
Yes.
But the bottom line is we have an operational bill right now. So the disclosure process has begun. That process has begun now. And the agencies are, in fact, engaged in the process of gathering the information together. And they have this deadline, this 300-day deadline now from December 22nd of 2023, on which date they have to have all of that information compiled, and it has to be prepared to be ready to be turned over to the National Archives. And then what the 24-page bill says, they thereafter have to turn it over to the National Archives as soon as possible after that date. Now, whatever that means, you know, it's not date specific. It's not even number of days specific. It just says as soon as possible. And so that's still left for some debate going on. But we do know that when the date of October 18th comes about, we'll be able to know how much information has been turned over to the National Archives. And at that point, it'll be time for the legislature to start jumping up and down and saying that, look, what's the reason why you haven't turned it all over, and how much of it have you designated as being authorized to be made available to the public? We'll have that information as of the 18th of October. And so that's the date that we're looking at right now. But in the meantime, the Senate has not given up on wanting to have the entire 64-page bill enacted into law. And so what happened is immediately after the House approved the 24 pages, and the 24 pages became law and was signed by the president, by President Biden, that the majority leader of the Senate, Chuck Schumer, and his co-sponsor, Michael Rounds from South Dakota, the Republican co-sponsor, they engaged in a colloquy on the floor of the Senate stating that they were completely unsatisfied with the bill that had been passed, the 24-page bill, and that they had every intention of coming back with a second round of passing a new statute through the Senate and sending it over to the House and insisting that it be approved. And so there is now prepared and in the hands of the United States Senate Intelligence Committee a UFO Disclosure Act 2.0 version, okay, which is substantially the same as the original bill. They've made some additional provisions of pointing out, for example, in the eminent domain portion of the bill that was to grant the power of eminent domain to that independent 9-person board of review to extract the information from the agencies and extract the information from the private aerospace industries. And very importantly, to lay claim to any of the technology, any of the crafts that have been turned over to any of the private aerospace corporations, that under the exercise of eminent domain, the United States government would reclaim its authority to own that property. Now, that has been a big sticking point.
It certainly has.
The aerospace industry was up in arms, basically, over that. But you know, they're not entitled to maintain private property any more than any other citizen would be, you know. And the Fifth Amendment, the United States Constitution, has the eminent domain provision in it, saying specifically that the United States government, as constituted under our Constitution, has the authority to exercise eminent domain over particular property, as long as they're willing to pay a reasonable fair market value for whatever the property is that they seize, and it has to be seized for a bona fide public interest. Okay,
so it'd be interesting to find out how they determine a fair market value for that particular property.
Well, it would be basically there's a doctrine in the law called quantum merit, which is that, you know, it's worth whatever the service is that they provided. You know, if that aerospace industry provided a certain number of man hours or person hours devoted to trying to understand the technology, they could be paid for that at a fair market rate, you know, of what it would cost to have that kind of research done.
Yeah.
But they don't, they're not entitled to own property rights to the title of to intellectual property rights to the property. That's the point of the debate right now. They want to have intellectual property rights over the technology, and that would give them the right to continue getting a portion of the value of that technology into the future for any open-ended amount of time. If that technology was ever used by anyone in the private sector or in the public sector, even, that they would be getting a share of whatever the market value was of that invention. That I don't agree with. I don't believe that they have to be given intellectual property rights to something. That's like saying that if the United States government engages, say, Boeing company to say, look, here's a craft. Tell us how this craft works. How does the propulsion system work? You know, and that you apply your time, you devote some of your scientists' time to this, and then you tell us what the technology is and how it works. Fine. And then we'll pay you for that service, but not give you the technology. You don't all of a sudden come to own the technology just because you've been asked to do some research on it. So that's what the point of the debate really is right now. And so they've put into the language of the second iteration of the document an attempt to clarify that. And there's some kind of a negotiation going on right now between the Senate Intelligence Committee people and the private aerospace people to try to work out some sort of reasonable accommodation for them to get some kind of reasonable compensation for the work that they've done on analyzing this technology. And that's where the debate, that's where the discussion is going on at the present time.
Have you ever read Communion? Or have you never read Communion? It's out in a new edition. Very powerful, a subtly new cover that reflects the fact that the visitors are now looking back at us because they truly are. You can get it
from the unknowncountry.com store as a Kindle, as a beautiful, sumptuous paperback, or as an unabridged audiobook read by me, it's the first time in the whole life of communion that it has been read in full in audio format. And believe you me, I felt that reading. I put my life, my memories into it. And I trust you can hear it in the voice. I sure felt it while I was reading. So get communion. Listen to it. Read it. Communion is of central importance to all of our lives.
Hi, everyone. This is Kelly Chase. I'm Dreamland's new monthly guest host. You can catch me here on the last Friday of every month. If you're interested in checking out my other work, you can find that on my podcast, The UFO Rabbit Hole. On that show, I share my own personal research with deep dives into everything from historical cases to philosophical frameworks, as well as in-depth interviews with top thinkers in the field, like Jeffrey Kripal, Diana Walsh-Pasulka, Bernardo Kastrup, James Madden, and of course, Dreamland's own Whitley Strieber. You can find The UFO Rabbit Hole on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, YouTube, or wherever else you listen to podcasts. Just search for The UFO Rabbit Hole. And if you like what you hear and you want to go even further down the rabbit hole with me, I'd like to invite you to join my Patreon community. Patrons get perks like early access to new content and ad-free episodes. I host twice monthly patron-only Zoom calls where you can ask me questions, share your own thoughts, and connect with others. We also have a lively and active private Discord server where members host book clubs, happy hours, and just share their thoughts on all things anomalous without all the drama that's all too common on social media. It's a warm, open-minded, and vibrant community, and we'd love to have you join us. Memberships start at just $5 a month. You can sign up at patreon.com/UFO rabbit hole. That's patreon.com/UFO rabbit hole.
So it could be said that it's possible that the aerospace defense industry perhaps privately lobbied the Congress, not the Senate, to create a better bargaining position for itself, and that's going on now.
That is clearly right. That is, well, actually, it wasn't even so much a bargaining thing. Is they're just adamantly saying they're going to refuse to turn this over unless they can be given intellectual property rights to the technology. They're not even negotiating it. You know, they don't want to.
The reason would be is that they're all, I know of this quite certainly in a couple of few cases, there have already been patents that have been granted on essentially false information, saying that the origin of the patents, the design and so forth, you know this, that this has been something that has been developed when it actually has not been developed but been found.
Yeah, that's part of the argument now, specifically that Colonel Corso had indicated that when Philip Corso was the head of the development of foreign technology in the United States Pentagon, and he has maintained that the silicon chip, for example, the night vision equipment, also the technology of the light going through the tubes.
We both know what it is, and I hope some of the listeners do too.
They apparently have, in the past, the United States government or whoever was in charge of that particular program allowed some of the private corporations that were going to develop that technology into civic on the civil side to claim a patent to that. So there's going to have to be a negotiation about that, about whether they're going to be allowed to keep that patent. Whether that was legally done or not. And that's one of the things they're afraid of, and why they're fighting back so hard is they don't want a bona fide legal analysis to be undertaken with regard to the legitimacy of that decision on the part of the government, because it has given, you know, untoward competitive advantage to those companies that got that technology
over and
above their competitors. And that's a violation of the antitrust laws. So that's part of the negotiation that's going on right now about whether or not there's going to be an allowance made for any of the patents that have already been granted. But our new Paradigm Institute is taking a very clear position that this technology, number one, there should be an absolute prohibition against the utilization of any of this technology for any military purposes. This should not be made available to military. That's number one. Number two, that we should establish a treaty with all the other nations of the world, that none of this technology should ever be allowed to be used for any military purpose. If we're going to be able to make this available for civilian use and for the benefits of getting an alternative source of energy, a clean energy source, or any of the other technologies they might have, even though that's quite disruptive of the present economies, we can figure that out on the civilian side. But we cannot allow this to be used for the military at all. And that's, of course, the most profitable use of this technology is in the
military. Yeah, because it's already been used for the military extensively. Yeah.
And it has to be clawed back. You know, they have to claw back that technology and be able to establish some kind of a bilateral set of agreements with Russia and China and perhaps India and some others that may have tried to utilize this technology for military developments. That's an area this is one of the areas for that board of review. That's why that was so important. That in the 64-page bill passed by the Senate, there was a UAP records review board that they proposed be set up, an independent group of 9 people to be appointed by the president. Our New Paradigm Institute is it's the only civilian group under the name of the UAP Disclosure Foundation to nominate people for that board. And we had gone through the process of lifting up some people to be potential nominees for the president of that board before the board was cut out of the bill by the House. That board is part of the second iteration of the Senate bill now. We want to have that independent board appointed, and they're the ones that are going to be, as I said, making the decisions as to what information is going to be made available to the public. A very important provision, an extremely important provision of the 64-page bill from the Senate side was that every single piece of information that was obtained by any of our military services, intelligence agencies, Defense Department agencies, or any aerospace company, any piece of information that was obtained 25 years ago or more had to be revealed to the public. That's the sort of standard period for being able to maintain a classification of any particular piece of information. So that was an important provision of the 64-page bill, and that only the president of the United States himself, or in the future herself, would be able to keep secret any particular piece of information that was more than 25 years old. Now, that, of course, as you and I both know, covers an extraordinarily important amount of information.
It certainly does. No. It's not going to happen to either, because most of the work on, I'm not going to go into details, but a lot of the work on what is now very important weapons technology goes back more than 25 years into mm-hmm. this area. Mm-hmm. I want to go back just briefly to the this review board. Yes. And there is, of course, a community in the United States and in the world of millions of people who have had contact because somebody is not just flying around. They're actually coming into our homes, and yes, we're living with this. Is there, and I, when I heard that and the motivation for this board, I thought to myself, surely someone from this community would be on such a board. But then I think to myself, here I am trying to bring forward the legitimate presence of a community that the people who are actually trying to do this and who are on the side of that community are afraid to admit even exists. So, right, you know, so where do we go from there? I don't think that board can be effective unless it is, there is someone from this community who has a stake in it.
Mm-hmm. Well, there are two, there are two slots still. There are of the nine members of the board, seven of those slots are described in the bill, in the 64-page bill. That, for example, one of the positions has to be a person who has national security experience in the government. Another one has to be a scientist, a physicist scientist that can understand these things. One of them has to be a professional historian. There are certain criteria like this that are in the bill, but it only covers seven of the nine positions. And there are two open-ended positions that would be able to be filled by an experiencer. There's no prohibition against an experiencer being there. There's no mandate that there be such an experiencer. And you're not going to get Congress to specifically designate one of those seats as a seat for the experiencers.
Because, well, I have to think that maybe the fact that they've been left open-ended is an invitation in a sense, because obviously they can't designate it. No.
That's right. That's right. And so that's the I've always been aware of the fact that those two seats are available for experiencers, and so that's we would take that into account as the New Paradigm Institute in making recommendations to the president.
Well, I certainly do hope you do that because it's very important. I know the presence, or whatever you want to call it, the aliens or the visitors, well enough to know that basically it's not going to work. Whatever we do isn't going to work unless there is some kind of give and take with the people who have already come into contact, because they've been brought into contact for many reasons, some of which aren't in our interests and others of which are.
You could even argue that one of the two open seats ought to be filled by an extraterrestrial being.
I wonder if that would be possible, because there are people here who might as well be that. I don't want to go down that path.
Right.
But there are such people, and I wonder if they would ever come forward. That would be very interesting.
Once you're into this world where for 80 years, all of the people in positions of authority have been denying emphatically that UFOs even existed. You know, now that we've crossed that line and we're into this world of acknowledging that UFOs are real, and that there is an assumption that there is a non-human intelligence, that's the term that they keep using now, a non-human intelligence that is behind the operation of these UFOs, that the question of there being a representative on the panel a representative of this non-human intelligence, if you assume it's something other than a computer. And the bottom line is that this board is being re-insisted upon by the Senate. So that's going to be part of the bill. Now, very importantly, turning to a slightly different aspect of this is that the board that is supposed to be put in place to deal with this is going to be part of the negotiation that goes on with the House, because the House not only doesn't want, they don't want any agency independent of the private agent or the government agencies that have possession of this information right now. They don't want any independent body to exist to be able to make determinations as to what should be made public. So that is an absolutely critical element of the negotiation that's going on now. And unless and until the House agrees to allow such an independent board, the Senate side is going to be having to demonstrate that there is going to be more and more information publicly released out from under a controlled disclosure process. That means that there are some 40 witnesses now that have come forward to the Senate Intelligence Committee who have provided sworn, verified, corroborated evidence to the Senate Intelligence Committee about the existence of this UFO crash retrieval program and the back engineering program. These witnesses are now already in place. They've already provided their evidence, and they're available for public testimony. And the United States Senate Intelligence Committee has the constitutional authority to present these people in public in the same way that the House Oversight Committee presented Colonel David Grush to come forward and assert on the public record that he is aware of a UFO crash retrieval program and a back engineering program that has been underway. So that unless and until the House of Representatives is willing to, and that is more specifically, that Michael Turner, who is the Republican chairman of the House Intelligence Committee, and Michael Rogers, who is the Republican chair of the House Armed Services Committee, and Michael Johnson, who is the present Speaker of the House, until these three men agree to approve of the controlled disclosure program that the Senate has proposed putting in place and this independent review board, the Senate is in the process of preparing to start moving forward one witness after another in a public set of hearings to begin to apply pressure to the House to say that if you aren't going to allow an overseen controlled disclosure process, then there's going to be a non-controlled disclosure process that is going to be taking place.
It's not going to be non-controlled. It's going to be controlled by the visitors.
But as you know, that there's a good deal of information that is in the possession of our government already, which they are exercising the decision over how much is going to be disclosed. Let's say that obviously the visitors themselves are in possession of 100% of the information.
Yeah, they're a very complex divided group. So that's right. And it's not monolithic.
That's right. And some certain of the civilizations and the species may have a lot more information than others about the nature of ultimate reality, et cetera. But you assume that somehow within the UFO community, the extraterrestrial community, that they possess 100% of the information. Our government, it's not clear yet what percentage of that information is known by our government. It's probably less than 100%. It's more than 0%, as they profess. But if they even have 10% or 20% of the information, they're refusing to provide any of it. And so that's what we have to, we're trying to carve into that that area. If they have 10 to 20% of the knowledge, we want to find out how much of it we can get made public. And one of the questions that keeps on presenting itself is whether or not any of us that are in the UFO community, whether we're going to agree to have any of it kept secret? Is there any reason why it should be kept secret? And you know, we obviously are well beyond just trusting the United States national security state.
Would be unusual.
Yeah. Yeah, we're not into trusting them to say, oh, just take our word for it. There's stuff you shouldn't know, you know. And then we say, like what? And they say, well, we can't tell you because you don't have the proper security clearances, you know. And that's not going to work. That didn't work for the Pentagon Papers case when they tried to tell us that in the Pentagon Papers case, because we don't trust them, and we don't trust them for good reason, because they've lied to us for 80 years. They've lied to Congress for 80 years. So that we're not going to take their word for it. So there has to be some mechanism by means of which we come to know what the information is that they're insisting be kept secret. And we need to make some kind of an independent judgment. Some of us who are going to be given access to that information as to whether or not we agree that there's any good reason for keeping any of it secret. Now, for example, we know that it's not appropriate to have the New York Times publish on the front page of the New York Times the intricacies on how you go about making a hydrogen bomb. That's fine, but nobody's proposing that we do that. You know, so the question is how do we make a determination within the UFO community if there is anything that is legitimately entitled to be kept secret? Unless at least some of us know what that is and can exercise an independent judgment about that. That's a major issue that's going to have to get resolved here.
There's a new world coming if we can take it. What does that mean? The first part of the message is if we can take it for ourselves on our own terms. The second part of the message is, can we bear the newness and the huge expansion of human consciousness that is going to be involved? Can we take it? A new world. It doesn't mince words. It tells the good, the bad, and the ugly like it is. And it leaves a message behind. Can you do this? Do you want to? Do we have an alternative? Right now, at this point in history, mankind is either going to get a lot bigger or not. I choose to go forward. I choose to live for and in the future. I choose the future. A new world. We can take it. Available in hardcover, softcover, audiobook, and Kindle. Where is the unknown country? Is it out there in the stars? Or is it also somewhere else? Is it in us, in you? Unknown country, join us today. Go to unknowncountry.com right now and join us. Join the questions. Join the search. Join the adventure. Unknowncountry.com. There's no place like it in the world.
I think that there is a sort of perhaps something that isn't clear, and that is the influence of, and I'm calling them visitors. You can too, because you're talking to me, and that's my sort of term. But I really don't know if it's an appropriate term or not. We don't know if any of the terms we use are appropriate. Mm-hmm. In any case, this presence. Has a stake, big stake, in what is disclosed. Mm-hmm. And it seems clear to me from being a close encounter witness myself and having had sexual material forcibly removed from my body that whatever motives were behind that action, and it's happened to many, many people. That aside, I can certainly see a motive to not allow that information to become fixed in the public consciousness, for the simple reason that whoever's doing it will be impeded by a public who is aware of the threat. Right now, what I know to be actually a very vulnerable and not very numerous group of individuals armed with certain skills and abilities and technology that does enable them to overwhelm people in unusual ways are doing this. And if we understood that and it was public knowledge, it would become very difficult for them to continue. They're not going to let that information out, I don't think.
Well, it's interesting, Willie, as you know, that this is one of the most widely disseminated pieces of information pertaining to the UFO phenomenon in the entire world.
It's not definite. It's still in a cloudy area. There's no official level of
acknowledgement,
precisely. Yeah. And until that happens, people will remain passive.
Well, it's very interesting. I mean, that I know that this is one of the major issues that has been raised. That I know that within our organization, the Romero Institute, which is the 501c3 public interest organization that's like 40 years old now, that the New Paradigm Institute is a major project of our 501c3 organization. I know that one of the major issues of fairly intense discussion inside the Romero Institute was this question about the abductions and the forcible extraction of women's eggs and male sperm, and the quite obvious program, a hybridization program that's going on right now with the UFO phenomenon. That it's interesting that a huge percentage of the what we call the UFO community, the people who pay any significant amount of time and attention to this subject, are aware of this program going on. They're convinced that it's going on, and that there have been varying degrees of acceptance of this program, even though the vast majority of the people who would be subjected to this involuntary extraction of reproductive materials have been offended by it and are outraged at it. There have been some, at least limited number of people who have come to sort of acquiesce to this and acknowledge that, you know, maybe there's some extraordinarily important thing. For example, the hypothetical that is discussed is that if, in fact, one or more of these extraterrestrial species are engaged in harvesting organic material from our planet, because our planet is one of the comparatively rare planets that gestates life, actually. This planet gestates life itself. And that this is one of the places where that this biological material can be harvested and brought to other planets where it might be available to be developed, life on other planets within our star system. That if there's a benign motive involved on the part of any of these extraterrestrial species in doing something like that, the question is whether they could obtain volunteers who would be willing to provide this information, subject themselves to in vitro fertilization processes. There are human biological processes now that are actually actively going on, where egg cells are removed from women and sperm cells are made available by men, and then they have in vitro fertilization. It goes on right now. there may be a number of people that would be willing to donate biological material if they knew that such a program was going on, and it would eliminate this involuntary kind of traumatic type of activity that we've got records that are going on right now. But that's an important area. And the question is whether or not any element of our American government, United States government, has entered into any such agreements to make any such materials available. But okay,
that's an interesting question, because if you let me roll back a little bit, I've often wondered whether or not the United States government entered into an agreement to allow them to come into the lives of the of people, because I asked them while it was happening to me. I said, you have no right. And they said, we do have a right. And before I had, once I was starting, I hadn't even started writing Communion, when none other than David W. Webb showed up in our life, a wonderful, sweet man who was also as deep inside an insider as you could imagine. If you look at Dr. Webb's Wikipedia page, he was consulting to every three alphabet agency in the country. And he came to our cabin. He was very interested, very supportive and friendly, had dinner at our house, and became a friend. Now, where did he come from? That's not so clear. But one thing is clear. He introduced me to an allergist who knew how to give me what allergy injections to give me so that when I was with these individuals for any extended period, I wouldn't get an overwhelming allergic reaction, and also left us with epinephrine injectors to leave all over the cabin in case they came in while other people were there, which happened. And we never needed to use the injectors, but some of the people who did have encounters at the cabin did have very severe allergy reactions. Now, what I'm saying here is somebody in the government knows a lot more. And I wonder if this information will ever be extracted, even by the efforts you're making.
Well, I believe they will be.
I hope so.
Because we've had the experience in the past of being able to extract information from some of the deepest dimensions of the covert operations of the United States government, explicitly contrary to their desire, you know, and I believe that we're going to be able to get at this. So that the question is that if in fact a program could be established whereby people were willing to volunteer, like the women who would be able to normally make their egg cells available for in vitro fertilization, to have their own mates' sperm cells be moved together with them and then frozen in these in vitro fertilization programs, if they were willing to offer those egg cells and the men were willing to offer sperm cells for a hybridization program, if we were informed as to what it was that was really going on, if we were to agree to that.
There is a hybridization program. I'm not the only close encounter witness who knows some of these people. And yeah. I tell you right now, speaking, circling back to that board, I don't know anyone in that who is a hybrid, is in it actually a hybrid, who could sit on that board, largely because of two reasons. They are unbelievably, they have a great deal of difficulty. They're like autistics on steroids. They can't even bear to look at you. They also can't speak. They use fluent telepathy, and that's not going to work it's not going to work. And they're not pleasant. They're very cranky, very cranky. And their thought processes are radically different from ours. They don't think the way we do. And I can, and I will eventually do this, give a very detailed precis of exactly how that works and how they're different. But are there maybe other hybrids who are more like us? I don't know.
Mm-hmm. Well, the extraordinarily interesting thing is that we will see, because this process is underway now. That there's clearly a process that's underway. Once you get congressional representatives who are dependent upon satisfying or at least placating their own constituency, to in order to survive in the office. You know, these people are a threat, as if you will, to the national security state, because they have an interest in getting information that the national security state wants to keep secret. Now, they also, of course, have a certain interest in placating the national security state, because the national security state will unseat them if they lean too hard. And we know that they did that to Frank Church, for example. They did that to a number of other United States senators. Birch Bayh, for example, they unseated Birch Bayh. We know that they've done that in the past. What we're doing right now is we're trying to establish as amicable and as cooperative a process as is possible right now. And we will exhaust all of our administrative remedies of getting cooperation from the national security state to participate in this process in a constructive way. But if they refuse, then we will go to the hardcore kind of more litigation oriented way of getting at this, and we will apply direct citizen power to the elected representatives to get them to coerce cooperation from the national security state. We will do that if we have to. We're presently engaged in a process of trying to get this done in a cooperative manner. And if you're going to give us a grade at the present time, we probably have a little less than a 33% rate of success.
But that'll change with
the bill that we've gotten passed. So we have to keep at this. There was a 7-year period, as you know, in the bill, pursuant to which this information was going to be rolled out under what they called specifically a controlled disclosure campaign.
Right.
That was what the term was in the statute. Yes. And that's the plan, to roll it out over a 7-year period. That would have started at the end of 2023, so that they were looking toward having this information made available by 2030. So that's what we're looking at right now, and that we're going to remain steadfast in getting this done, and I believe that we're going to get it done.
This has been held secret through 14 presidential administrations. There have been a number of serious discussions. I know in October of 2008, and now that Hal Puthoff has talked about this publicly at the Seoul conference, I feel free to talk about it. There was a large meeting of individuals called together by the Bush White House to determine whether or not this should be made public.
Yes.
And everyone went into it thinking, yeah, they divided into a number of different committees. Yeah, let's do it. They came out of it uniformly saying, no, we can't do it for a whole lot of different reasons, some of which we've already discussed, that have to do with the economic issues and the legal issues that the defense industry is facing. However, and I'm sure that the issue of the abductions came up, but I've also wondered the degree to which this presence itself is involved in our efforts. In other words, there seems to be a kind of movement more and more toward this, and they have made it clear to me that as the planet's ability to support life deteriorates, they will come closer. Mm-hmm. And if it reaches a point where all of us know we are trapped here on a planet that is definitely dying, they will emerge, and that's going to be completely asymmetrical and very sudden. The question is this: is 2030 too late for us to maintain control of this ourselves, because it will be ceded by us if we're not quick enough? Free Dreamlanders, this is the point at which normally you would be cut off. I'm not cutting you off today because this is too important. It's absolutely essential that you get this information. You have to act. We all do. And you also have to act on behalf of unknowncountry.com. Fewer than 1% of our listeners subscribe to the site. So go to unknowncountry.com and subscribe today. It's very important. I have been keeping this up, myself and Anne, for over 20 years. Every year, we spend more on the website than we take in. And it's not easy to do this. It's a sacrifice. And I always get the feeling that, you know, you're just totally passive and you don't care. So cheer me up. Go and subscribe to unknowncountry.com. Go on the website and do it today. Free Dreamlanders, this is the point at which normally you would be cut off. I'm not cutting you off today because this is too important. It's absolutely essential that you get this information. You have to act. We all do. And you also have to act on behalf of unknowncountry.com. Fewer than 1% of our listeners subscribe to the site. So go to unknowncountry.com and subscribe today. It's very important. I have been keeping this up, myself and Anne, for over 20 years. Every year, we spend more on the website than we take in. And it's not easy to do this. It's a sacrifice. And I always get the feeling that, you know, you're just totally passive and you don't care. So cheer me up. Go and subscribe to unknowncountry.com. Go on the website and do it today.
I think that's a very real issue that we have to deal with. That they're wanting apparently to have us do this in an effective way, us rise to the occasion to solve some of our major problems. You know, of the thermonuclear weapons. They're clearly not going to allow thermonuclear weapons to be transported out into outer space and invade their territory with these weaponry. They're also clearly not going to allow the ability of our planet to gestate life to be permanently impaired. It's too valuable a resource in the galaxy. And they say it's not unique. It's clear that obviously that their life has been generated on other planets, or there wouldn't be these other extraterrestrial species. But it's a comparatively rare phenomenon. And they're not going to allow us to destroy the capacity of our planet to gestate life. Both of these things are clear. They've been clear about it. That the communications that have been given to by the extraterrestrial beings to many people who have had direct face-to-face encounters is, you've got to stop the new thermonuclear weapons. You've got to stop building them and deploying them. And you got to stop polluting your planet. You're polluting the entire life-generating capacities of your planet. You got to stop doing this. And so the warnings have been given. People have attempted to convey the warnings, but the national security state is so locked into denying the validity of these experiences that they're cutting off the credibility of the warnings.
That's exactly right.
So that's what we have to try to overcome. The New Paradigm Institute that has been established now in Washington is attempting to bring together all of the people that are involved in the UFO movement and to get everybody to cooperate together to stop this kind of internecine bickering that has gone on upon occasions, the competitiveness for the what people view to be limited resources for time and attention of the public. But we've got to get all moving in the same direction and bring to bear the power that we have as a huge constituency inside the United States. And this is the most bipartisan issue that I've ever seen in 50 years of working in the area of public interest, that I've never seen an issue where extreme conservatives in the Republican Party, extreme progressives in the Democratic Party, all the moderates and conservatives and liberals all agree that is completely inappropriate for the national security state to be lying to Congress in concealing this information from the legislative body in our democracy. And so that we now have the support of a growing number of the overwhelming majority members of the Senate and the House in our United States Congress. And we have the general desire on the part even of a Republican and Democratic executive administrations to do this. What we've got to do is address some of the reasons why they don't want to do it yet. You know, this gathering that came together in the W. Bush administration in 2008 to try to decide whether or not they were ready yet to start to release this information, that they kept pointing out that, well, there were all these hurdles because our economic system wasn't prepared to absorb the new technology. Our scientific community wasn't prepared yet to absorb the technological information. The religious institutions weren't prepared at the present time to absorb the kind of metaphysical dimensions of this. But the fact of the matter is, people still haven't been doing the work to get ready.
Well, yeah, but I think that let's put a little period on what actually happened in 2008, because yes, those are the things that were brought up, but behind that was the reality is and was that the defense industry is not prepared to face the lawsuits. That's the real problem. I can listen. I can tell you, and it goes beyond the defense industry. In the medical industry, there are super hard materials that have been used in or being used in medical implants, and certain companies are making a fortune because of the superior metallurgy that they possess, and that metallurgy comes directly from this through patent puppets who hold patents that actually are and I presume get royalties for those patents, and those patents are actually simply technology that was discovered a long time ago, back in the 80s, and eventually the metallurgical we learned how to actually apply these techniques to metals and make these extraordinary. Now you can get a knee implant, used to last maybe 30 years, but now you can get it. Someone who needs a knee implant or replaced metal knee at the age of 25 can get one and be assured it'll be there and working for the rest of their lives because of this. And that's where that information comes from. So that's a big thing beyond all of those. And I happen to think that everyone is prepared, and then I suspect the scientific community outside of this very arid, enclosed group of people who are working on this is far better prepared to deal with it than they are.
Yeah, and I believe also that we have examples of how to craft immunity for people. For example, in the technology now with the platforms, with the Facebook and Twitter and all these, the United States Congress was able to pass a law immunizing all of those new technological platforms from being held liable as a publisher for information that was being communicated by people on their platforms. You know, they passed the I think Section 230 of the
230. It's Section 230. You know, yes.
And it is it gives immunity to these platforms against lawsuits for libel or slander. And so that this could be done. I mean, you know, but the legislature has to get prepared for doing this. They have to come to grips with the knowledge that this is real, so that they can do it. And what we're going to do and are doing at the present time at the New Paradigm Institute in Washington is we're starting to try to develop concrete proposals as to how to go about doing this. You know, for every argument that is raised against revealing the information because we're not ready in a particular area to absorb the information, what we need to do is to put forth, here are the steps that you need to take to get ready. And that's what we're doing now. And very importantly, we're talking about reaching out to a number of the religious institutions to really start, you know, updating their theology. That we know that, for example, for decades, the writings of Teilhard de Chardin, Pierre Teilhard de Chardin, you know, who was a Jesuit paleontologist who was basically espousing an entire theology to really understand how the faculties that were displayed not only by Jesus, but have been displayed by the Buddha, by other major prophets, are a mutation of a biological set of capacities that our human family has. And they've been addressed in great detail in the Hindu tradition, for example, the development of these, what they call siddhas, that our human family is capable of doing, that they've been hidden and concealed, for example, inside the Catholic Church. They've been reserved for monks and people in monasteries and stuff like that to be able to ascend into these kind of higher states of consciousness and to download information and to be prescient in some other things. These are capabilities that our human family has, but the religious traditions have been guarding this.
Yes. Just like the Defense Department and defense industry is guarding other things. It's time to stop guarding. I agree with you.
That's right. And so that's what we have to reach. We have to start preparing the religious institutions to be able to share these secrets with the rest of the human family so that we can understand that we're much closer in relationship to some of these extraterrestrial beings that we see perform these kind of rather extraordinary feats. You know, that we need to realize that our human family is closer to that than we think they are.
You know, Danny, you're the first person I've heard say this outside of a very tiny group of people. That's really insightful, because then it gets to this, that the visitors aren't really a technological wizardry at all. This comes from them. It's them. It's their bodies.
Yes. Yeah.
And their ability to use their bodies and to fully express the real power that we also possess, but we've hidden from ourselves.
That's exactly right. And so that this preparation, we should take guidance from this event that took place back in 2008 that Hal Puthoff is now publicly talking about, saying, okay, here are the impediments that were articulated at that time to immediate disclosure. And the fact of the matter is there hasn't been an awful lot of progress made since 2008 in remedying those states of preparedness. And so that we need to get about doing that. And that is one of the many things that the New Paradigm Institute is dedicated to, is working out concrete plans and programs pursuant to which we can prepare our cultural, scientific and theological institutions among our human family to prepare for this. And that's what we really need to do. And that's what we're doing right now to try to alleviate the resistance to the full disclosure here. And we still have to figure out the maintenance of communication, somehow establish more direct communications with the extraterrestrial beings themselves, because you can't really allow just the national security state military people to have exclusive lines of communication going to these extraterrestrial beings. We've got to be able to develop direct citizen to citizen diplomacy. That's what we have to be able to do. That's how we did it with regard to the Soviet Union. You know, we had direct communications going with the people in the Soviet Union to try to lower the barriers of relationship and establish direct communications with Gorbachev to get him to be willing to dissolve the Soviet Union. You know, we were involved in that process directly. So we need to do the same thing with the extraterrestrial beings.
You know, it's a great regret of mine that this implant, that more people don't have this. I don't, maybe people do, I don't know. But over the years, it has become an absolutely essential tool. I can't do an interview with this like this without it. It's been working the whole time. And all my books are written with it. It's essential. And if we had people who had this kind of bridge, we would really be able, those people would be extremely useful in this process, especially if they were people with deep scientific knowledge and so forth, which I do not possess. Mm-hmm. And therefore, I can't ask the right questions and gain the right functionality. Its focus in me is communication. In other words, I'm a communicator, and that's what its focus is. It works with me in communication. I cannot imagine what it would be like if someone like like a great physicist could have one, and it would work with him in physics. Mm-hmm. How marvelous. And I think, I just wish it was possible. And I feel quite helpless. I want to go on, though, because you've mentioned the New Paradigm Institute a number of times, and we haven't really spent any time specifically talking about it. Can you, and the Romero Institute, too, if we get time, but can you give us a little bit of information about the origins of the New Paradigm Institute, what it is, how it's funded, and how it functions, and what it's going to do?
Yeah, well, this this conversation began between me and Dr. John Mack back in 1994, when John Mack contacted me and asked me to legally represent him in front of the Harvard Faculty Committee that had dragged him up in front of this committee because he wrote this book that was called Abductions, Human Contact with Aliens. I became legal counsel for the peer group, the Project for Extraordinary Experience Research. And John and I began discussing establishing a New Paradigm Institute at Harvard, if we could. Once we got through this confrontation with the faculty committee, we were actually contemplating trying to secure the Litauer Center at Harvard University, which was the old government building before they built the John F. Kennedy School, and to try to set up an institute there to try to get out ahead of this, you know, in each of the different fields of physics and science and philosophy and theology, et cetera, because we came to realize, it wasn't a great insight, but that this was a worldview clash that had happened here, that Harvard University, that prides itself as being sort of the seat of the liberal ethic in Western civilization, that Harvard University back in 1994 was completely opposed to allowing this discussion to take place. And what John and I decided, we needed to set up an institute to try to facilitate Harvard University itself in coming to grips with some of these, this modernization of their academic disciplines. And then John, as you know, unfortunately was killed in this accident that happened in 2004. And I kept on trying to figure out how we could go about establishing this New Paradigm Institute. And then what happened is I ended up becoming, as you know, I became legal counsel for the Disclosure Project with Dr. Stephen Greer and the people.
Right.
I became legal counsel for the citizens hearings with Stephen Bassett. And then I was retained by Lou Elizondo to represent him, who was the director of the Advanced Aerospace Threat Identification Project in the Pentagon. And so I was able to persuade our 501c3 public interest organization that we'd set up, that's been in operation for 40 years, our Romero Institute, to adopt a wholly integrated project of the New Paradigm Institute. So we set this up in 2020, and we now have been, we have gained funding. We have a structure. We have an office on Capitol Hill right next to the United States Senate, where we have regular conversations with the Senate Intelligence Committee staff. We have a communication now with the House Oversight Committee people. We have advisors that are inside the national security state bureaucracy that are advising us. And we're drafting alternative legislation to pass to try to address some of the internal issues that the government has to deal with. Now, we also have a course. We have the first university level course that is able to give full credit toward a master's degree and a PhD degree in extraterrestrial studies. We have this established now. I'm in the process of delivering the original 8 orientation lectures. I've delivered 4 of these already. The first one was dealing with the history over the last 80 years, the major events that people would need to become familiar with, you know, that obviously include things like the crash at Roswell, you know, the events that you've experienced, for example, that you recount in communion, other major historical incidents that have occurred. We've then dealt with the issue of the alternative explanations of the origin of the UFO phenomenon, from the extraterrestrial origins to potential extra dimensional origins, etc. And we've been going through these now and are working toward generating a master's degree credit at universities for this. And very importantly, we have been designated in the Senate bill as the civilian agency that will be making recommendations to President Biden as to who should be appointed to this 9-person review board. So that those are activities that we've been engaged in. And we're also engaged, very importantly, in attempting to craft a new paradigm worldview that actually integrates into the present octave of human worldviews that people are adherents to, you know, from the authoritarian to the reactionary to the conservative to the moderate to the liberal to the progressive to the utopian kind of worldviews that people hold, how these are going to be concretely modified so that they can absorb the reality of a larger extraterrestrial civilization of which we're a part. So these are some of the activities that we're engaged in a concrete way. And we're also going to be providing, we have 12 attorneys now that are working with us in our legal division to be able to provide actual legal representation to whistleblowers, to facilitate them coming forward and providing their information to the Senate and House so that we can move the legislative representatives into taking steps to get this information conveyed to the American people. And we have now just most recently in this past week, we've been approached by a major production company in Los Angeles that free of charge is going to make available to us the capacity to produce documentary films, major educational pieces, actual scripted dramatic series to recreate and to present to the American people and to the people of the world the historical events that have taken place pertaining to this particular subject. So we've got this media capacity now, and it's not for a profit. You know, we're a completely nonprofit organization. This distinguishes us completely from the To the Stars Academy, which was an attempt to kind of set up a commercial operation.
Right, yeah.
Money on this issue, which I was opposed to right from the very beginning. But we're a 501c3, completely public interest oriented organization. We're housed in a 40-year a 501c3 organization, has a full set of administrative capacities to monitor the contributions that get made to us, to give a full accounting of where the contributions come from and how they're used. So, you know, we've got a long history. We're the ones that did the Iran-Contra investigation, exposing the illegal weapons supply operations going to the Contras in violation of the Boland Amendment. We earlier did the Karen Silkwood case that exposed the smuggling of bomb-grade plutonium out of nuclear facilities in the United States to Israel to create a nuclear weapons system for Israel and for Iran, I might point out. That I had earlier done the Pentagon Papers case for the New York Times. I was the one that initiated the case that established the right of journalists to protect their confidential news sources, to be able to get access to kind of inside information like this. So we have a long track record of working in the public interest area and being effective in this area and trusted. So that's one of the reasons why, for example, Lou Elizondo came to us to have us represent him when he decided he was going to come forward and provide this information to the New York Times And he was retaliated against by elements inside the defense industry. He retained me to assist him in this. And I've been representing Lou ever since then. And Lou is in the process now of publishing a major book that's just coming through now, the Defense Department pre-publication review and security clearances that are, they're being finalized now. So we're engaged in an activity bringing together different leaders of different UFO groups in the community now to try to work cooperatively with each other to alleviate any kind of tension between the organizations so that we can all be working in the same direction. And we've been able to work with a bipartisan alliance in the House and Senate of both Republicans and Democrats at the highest levels, and even in the most extreme elements of the extreme conservatives and the extreme progressives inside the Republican and Democratic Party, respectively. This is a, what we're trying to do is bring to bear all of the benefits of the experiences that we've had over the past 50 years, not only working in the UFO area, but working in all these areas of attempting to extract information from the national security state to stop them from engaging in unconstitutional activity. That's what the New Paradigm Institute is doing right now. And we have a major website that is set up now. People can get to a newparadigminstitute.org. It's very simple. It's newparadigminstitute.org. People can just go onto the internet and get to our website. They can link into the resources of this. You can link into knowing who your congressperson is and the United States senators. There are pre-prepared communications that you can just push a button, basically, and have letters sent to your congresspeople and senators, giving them support, since the overwhelming majority of them support the 64-page bill that we are advocating. And have gotten the support for the entire United States Senate behind, you know, so that we in a certain sense, it's, you know, we're not trying to overstate our, but are trying to legally help represent the interests of the United States Congress vis-a-vis the national security state here, that we're able to be much more aggressive and more forward leaning than a lot of the kind of legal attorneys inside the government may be. They may be much more circumspect about what they do than we can do. We're perfectly happy and willing to represent whistleblowers, for example, whereas people that are inside government institutions, lawyers, would feel hamstrung to really be able to represent a whistleblower that may be revealing information that the same government employer that they're employed by wouldn't want done. So we are able to provide these kind of legal services. And we're able to provide the theological and philosophical and political and economic reflection that needs to be done by us as civilians.
Danny, that's a perfectly beautiful answer. And it brings me to, we're coming to the end of our time together. And I'm sure, like every listener, I wish you well and take care of that cough. We need Danny Sheehan in this business finally.
Mr. Colbert. I've been running around too much with not enough sleep.
Well, you're not alone. The New Paradigm Institute and the defense industry and Defense Department, on one side is a monolith capable of losing routinely billions upon billions of dollars and then saying, well, we just can't balance our budget. We don't know why. On the other side is a little 501c3 that knows how to make a lot of noise without a lot of cash. So folks, do go to newparadigminstitute.org and learn what you can do, because no one counts more in this than the people. And the people who are most interested to the visitors and what they do and how they act in this are those of you who have had contact with them. You are their leading edge. Danny, thank you so much for being with us.
Terrific, Whitley. I really appreciate it. Thank you so much for everything you're doing.
Oh, thank you.
It's beyond words to thank you, Danny.
Thank you so much, sir.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by UnknownCountry.com and its family of subscribers. Our theme music is The O of Pleasure by Ray Lynch. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host. And I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander.